praise you for another morning to be able to come into your house and worship you, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. We just thank you for resting on us this morning with your spirit. We just thank you for this time to come together as a church body for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
My
My life surrendered, my heart abandoned, more of you.
Hallelujah.
Cross me, pull me the world behind. I'm turning back, raise the banner high. It's not for us, it's all for you. Let the heaven shake and split the sky. Let the people clap their hands and cry. It's not for us. Your holy fire on this offering, let our worship burn for the world to see. It's not for us, it's all for you. Not to us, to your name be the glory. Not to us.
The waves are crashing, the sun is raging. It's all for you. The universe is spinning and singing, all for you. Your children dancing, 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 yeah. It's all for you, it's all for you.
Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. dust, the only one that could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. We live for you.
let faith arise. In spite of what I see, Lord, I believe. But help my unbelief, I choose to trust you. No matter what I feel, let faith arise. Let faith arise. For my champion's not dead, he is alive. And he already knows my every need. And surely he will come and rescue me. let this be a sacrifice. Let me dedicate my life to worship you. Won't you let this be a sacrifice? Let me dedicate my life to worship you. Oh, come and let this be a sacrifice. Let me dedicate my life to worship you. And won't you let this be a sacrifice? Let me dedicate my life to worship you. I'm a lover of your presence. I'm a lover of your presence. I'm a lover of your presence. And it's all I want to be. I'm a lover of your presence. I'm a lover of your presence. I'm a lover of your presence. And it's all I want to be.
Stirring deep inside you, all that really satisfies me, worship you. A passion stirring deep inside you, all that really satisfies me, worship you. Oh, a passion stirring deep inside you, all that really satisfied, we worship you. Oh, our passion stirring deep inside you, all that really satisfied, we worship you.
And I was made for loving you. Yes, I was made for love. I was made for love. And I was made for loving you.
I was made for love. I was made for love.
for loving you. Oh, I was made for love. I was made for love. I was made for loving you.
Fellowship, Pastor Robert will be starting that back up, and it will be figure
which
that out.
Which Saturday?
On the, I'm fixing to get to that. Hold on. On the 27th. So you may get to come and you get to fellowship with one another. And we need you men at TCF to be a part of this. Y'all hear me? Because right now, I'm telling you, we need our men to lead us in every area. We don't need the women outdoing the men and the hunger and the thirsting for God and things of God in these last days. So go ahead and put it on your calendar. It's on the 27th at 10 o'clock. Put your work schedules to the side if you can. I mean, God's got to be a priority, y'all. I'm just going to say that. God is doing a shift, and I've already told y'all that. And if he is not number one in your life, you're going to be shifting. I'm just going to let you know. Because this last shifting is going to be for those who are ready to be a part of the army. And to be a part of that army, you've got to hunger and thirst for the things of God. You can't have one foot in the world and one foot in church. Jesus can't be on your time. You got to be on his time, because that's just how it is. If he's your Lord, and we have to look at ourselves. I was sharing with a friend of mine last week on the phone that we can say God's our Lord, but look, when we look at our life, we know what's Lord, and we can try to deny it, but Jesus sees it too. And I was telling her, I said, I have to get my priorities straight. I know I have to get my priorities straight. God is telling me that, and I can look at it and see, because my work consumes too much of our time. And it can't be like that. He's got to be number one. And so I'm just sharing that with y'all from my perspective. I don't want to be sifted. So I'm going to start sacrificing for my Lord, and he's going to be the Lord of my life.
Amen.
You know, amen. And I hope y'all will get to that point too, because there's a generation of people out there that need us. They need the army of Christ. And whether God's going to have his army, I'm just going to let y'all know. Devil ain't bigger than God. The remnant is going to rise up.
Amen.
The question is, are you part of that remnant?
Yes, amen.
Amen. And you got to want to be part of that remnant. You got to get out of the things of this world. And there's going to be a lot of stuff the Holy Spirit's going to start sifting out of our lives. And we have to make a decision to sacrifice and get rid of that stuff. It's not worth it. Amen.
Amen.
So that'll be on the 27th of August at 10 o'clock. So those are a couple new things that we've added in. So we're going to go to birthdays. We have birthdays. Yesterday was Aria's birthday. She turned 3 years old, so we got to go see her and took her to the sugar factory. So that was fun, just to see her, you know, on her birthday and see how 3 years just went by so fast. But she's a sweet little girl. And so yesterday was her birthday. And the 10th is our other granddaughter's birthday. Princess Destiny is what we call her. She's our little princess, because we just always call her that. So she will be turning 18.
Wow.
Jeez. 18
wow.
Years old, yes. And then A.W. and Arlene's Prince Hank. Prince Hank. He was, let's see what he, Hank the Movie Man. That's what they was calling him. His birthday is on the 11th, the day after Destiny's.
And you sure how old he is?
And he'll be 19.
40 years old, praise God.
40.
He's looking good for 40, ain't he?
Hold on now.
No, don't take that wrong. I'm just saying. Your dad's 30?
Yep.
Wow, yes. But y'all don't take that wrong. But I'm saying, Hank, happy birthday. We're saying happy birthday to you, Hank, even though you're not with us this morning. You're enjoying your time. Your break. So just remember that. Make sure you tell them happy birthday. And now it's y'all's turn. I want to know what the Lord's done for y'all this week. Is anything on your heart? So what does he
hot egg? She said maybe they should change the nickname to hot egg
now. Okay. Get back in the spirit.
Found out what trials and tribulations and who they come from.
Praise God.
That is the big thing right now that we overcome. And I've been through trials and tribulations as long as I can remember. But God has brought me through. close. This is living by the power of the Holy Ghost. This is, so now the case is closed. There remains no accusing voice of condemnation against those who are joined in life union with Jesus, the Anointed One. For the law of the Spirit of life, flowing through the anointment of Jesus, has liberated us from the law of sin and death. For God achieved what the law was unable to accomplish, because the law was limited by the weakness of human nature. Yet God sent us His Son in human form to identify with human weakness. Clothed in humanity, God's Son gave His body to be the sin offering for that God could once and for all condemn the guilt and power of sin. So now every righteous requirement of the law can be fulfilled through the Anointed One.
Amen.
Living His life in us, and we are free to live not according to our flesh, but by the dynamic power of the Holy Spirit. Those who are motivated by the flesh only pursue what benefits themselves, but those who live by the impulse of the Holy Spirit are motivated by to pursue spiritual reality. For the mindset of the flesh is death, but the mindset controlled by the Spirit finds life and peace. The mindset focused on the flesh fights God's plan and refuses to submit to His direction because it cannot. For no matter how hard they try, God finds no pleasure with those who are controlled by the flesh. But when the Spirit of Christ empowers your life, you are not dominated by the flesh, but by the Spirit. And if you are not joined to the Spirit of the Anointed One, you are not of Him. Now Christ lives His life in you. And even though your body may be dead because of the effects of sin, His life-giving Spirit imparts life to you because you are fully accepted by God. Yes, God raised Jesus to life, and since God's Spirit of resurrection lives in you, He will also rise your dying body to life by the same Spirit that breathes life into you. So then, beloved ones, the flesh has no claim on us at all, and we have no further obligation to live obedient to it. For when life controls the flesh, you are about to die. But if the life of the Spirit puts to death the corrupt ways of the flesh, we then taste His abundance life.
Glory. Thank you, Jesus, for that word. Amen.
Glory.
Anybody else got anything? It's awesome. Yes.
Oh, I'll be over there, Gilden.
You would tell me about Gilden, or you have?
No, I have something that was for me.
Okay. Sorry, Gilden, I'm coming.
Container. And this, when you were talking, you were singing about because it would poison you. It's not there saying, oh, love to worship him. You will worship him if you are of him. And if you are of him, you will be of love, and you will not be contaminated by the things of this world. In correspondence to what he just read, it's the same thing in a different form. It's God is not up there hunting for your love. You don't have to love him if you don't want it to love and hurt you. He made you because he is a lover, and he cannot produce anything that is not love. And you're a container made for love. So when you go out of love, you're drinking poison. He's not needy. You're his child, and you're made of love. And every time you do unlove-filled, whatever that is, you are contaminating your body. So there's no need to feel guilty. Just walk in love, and it will work out.
Sadly in this world,
post, and everybody knows about how the Roe versus Wade abortion situation got overturned and stuff. So obviously a lot of women are not happy about that. So this one woman made a claim now, you know, she's not happy about, you know, what's going on. I, without hesitation, commented, I forgot what I said exactly. And then I did not expect for what was going to happen when I said that, just correcting them though. That's really basically what I did though. It lasted the whole day. I mean, I get almost 40 replies, tons of reactions to the stuff I'm saying, to the stuff that other people are saying. It was just madness, and I'm just like, what is going on? All I did was like just speak. All I did was speak the truth, and I had a lot of women coming for like my head. I got cussed out a couple times in the comment section. Like it got that bad, and you know I'm just laughing because I'm like shocked, but at the same time I didn't care because I'm just like, I mean, the truth can definitely hurt. I mean, I've never been there where the truth was spoken to me and it hurt, but I mean, can't do nothing about it when, you know, if you're wrong about something. But you know, I'm just thankful that, you know, you can be in the situation used by God to start off, you know, something so good, you know, kind of brings you to tears, you know, just pure love. And then you be in another situation where you're also being used by God. But it's just a lot of, you know, it's a lot of tension because, you know, some people, they just, you know, in other situations, a little more stubborn. But, you know, either way, I'm grateful that God was able to use me. This is big.
You have to be, you have to stand firm in the truth of God's word, share it, and the devils, they don't like it, and we don't wrestle against people, but it's those devils that have deceived people, and because of the thing that has been broken off of America with what's been done, those devils are upset. They're thirsty, yes, and they want that. That was a big power that they had over our country. And it's been broken down, and they're still, it's kind of like what I look back of as gnashing of teeth is what's going on, y'all. So we have to stand firm, because if you just stand back, like Golden said, and look at the responses of why they are angry, it is all selfishness. And they're angry over a life. And the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy, y'all. And they're wanting their rights to their body to kill a baby. And even though they don't look at what it is, that is what it will become. That is what it is. It has a heart. So they've been deceived, and it's getting into the school systems. It's being taught to our children at very young ages. Selfishness is, and you have rights, and the parents are falling into it. Me and Robert have even said this. We'll ask little kids, what do y'all want to eat? And you'll get, if you have two of them, you're going to get two different opinions. And then they're going to expect you to do their opinion. And then we look at each other and we're like, why are we asking a 9-year-old? Why are we asking a 3-year-old? Because the bottom line is, it's not a debate. They are children. We are too. You know, it's okay if you want to bless them and say, hey, today's your special day. We'll go anywhere you want to. But we are the parents. We are the adults. And these kids, man, that it is coming from the school system. I got to share with Dusty. And I mean, Dusty likes to pick at me. But the whole thing with these binary, there are binary books in the schools. Y'all know that. So he's been moved into a librarian. But I told him, I said, do you order those books? Because I'm mama. I'm like, do you order those books? I said, if he comes down to you having to order those books, because he says the school boards are the ones getting them, but and putting them into the school, the Board of Education. I said, if it comes down to you have a decision, your decision better be, no, that's mama. It better be no. Don't you hook up with that. Don't you put that stuff in that school. I said, God moved you there. The position, I said, I really believe that him and Courtney are in the school systems for a purpose. And I said, and if it comes down to you standing up and losing your job, because you won't put something into a child that goes against your Christian beliefs and God, then you just have to, but I can tell him that and I can want it, but he's got to see it too. And I tell my kids that all the time. Sabrina is a big advocate for going against abortion.
Pro-life.
She's pro-life, very pro-life. She has got had people attack her online, but she don't care. You know, that's where we got to get. You know, we don't, and realize we're not wrestling against people. It's a baby, it's a child, amen? And that's where we're gonna be. But we're gonna be ready, because when there is no place for these women to go with these babies, the church has got to be there. It may be open up your home to help somebody. It may be taking a child. It may be adoption, the foster care system. I heard this week, if every Christian family in America would take just one child, there would be no foster care system. Just one child. But it's a sacrifice. So, again. But I'm not telling you to go do it. I'm just telling you, get ready, Christians. God has done what he needs to do. We got to do what we're supposed to do.
I don't need the mic. Sabrina, one of the things you can say is when you have consent to have sex, you gave up that right.
Oh, I did.
Yeah, you have lost that right, and you have decided to help in the creation of the life and all your
other. Sure.
Yeah. and you know what, God, and love them, because there's a whole other ministry out there that I listen to, and this woman is loving on the mothers who have made those decisions, and she's sharing the stories of these mothers that's had to make the decision, and there are many reasons why. There's children that were forced by their parents. They say, like, you make a choice. You know, they didn't have the right thing. They made them get abortions, and they tried their best not to, and so they're living with this, and so they can't come to church. Family, we're love. We got to feel condemnation, because that child is with Jesus. That, you know, that's where that child went. It's just that, like, there's a whole generation, how long Roe versus Wade was in effect, that we have lost.
But this is it. You know, we get so sanctimonious, but when we look at somebody and which they're dead, we're not doing anything different than a woman who had an abortion.
Yes, we got
to
be loved.
So if we look at it that way, it will be easy to say, come on, baby, because of this day, we love you.
Yes, we got to walk in love. We got to preach against, we got to teach the truth, because like you said, your decision is not happening. If we would do what God said, abstain until marriage, that it all goes back. The devil is here to destroy the family. He's here to destroy our children. He's going after our children right now. And I gotta let it go, because everybody's looking at me like the couple up here. But anyway, that's what we gotta do. We gotta protect our children. And we're gonna be moved in positions where we're gonna have to make a stand, y'all. It's time to make a stand. And it's time to not be like going all day long. It was a sacrifice. You deal with that all day long, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
You get frustrated.
It started around like 1 Saturday, and it lasted like 10
Yeah, it frustrates you. You want to turn your phone off. But you know what? If he's speaking truth to them, that you're sowing a seed. So you sow the seed. God sends somebody to water that seed, and then the seed comes to pass. So you can turn your phone off and say, I ain't even dealing with this. These people are crazy. No, you got to go back to what the Spirit says. We don't wrestle against people. It's the demonic stuff. And there are crazy things happening. That's my last thing. There are crazy things happening against people. Attacks are happening because he's trying to see if you're going to be firm. The enemy's trying to tear you down and keep you down. And like you said, the only way you can overcome attacks is with the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. So with that being said, y'all come on up. There's different ways. If you look up there, King David has listed if you want to give them different ways. But if you'll raise up your tithes and offerings to the Lord right now, and remember, stretch offering, we're going to pray over it. Father, we just thank you for the opportunity, Father, to just sow into your kingdom. We thank you for the words, Holy Spirit, that you've shared with us this morning during this time, and that it'll get inside of us, Lord. And Father, we ask you to give wisdom and knowledge to those that oversee the money here at True Christian Fellowship, that it will go into your kingdom, into the ministries that you have called us into. And Father, we thank you that and your time in our building will come into fruition, whether it's this building or it's another building, but wherever you plant us, Father God, we will be where you've called us to be, and we were going to occupy now until that happens, or if we stay here, but we ask you, Father, lead us into this community. Show us how to reach this community that we're in and raise up mighty warriors out of this church, Father God, for your kingdom and for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Communion time. Praise God. Father, we just thank you. Every time we do this in remembrance of what Jesus did for us at the cross. And Father, we partake of this cracker as if his body was broken for us. Father, we break this cracker resembling what he did for us. And Father, we just so thankful that his body provided healing for us, health for us. And Father, the sacrifice provided for us to have everything we need in this life. And we give you all praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, we thank you that this juice represents the blood of Jesus that paid for our debt on sin. Father, we thank you there's no more sin problem. Father, we believe today. We accept what Jesus did for us on the cross, and we're thankful you accepted the blood from him as payment for the sin. And we give you all praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. We have praised God. He's worthy. Hallelujah. Worthy to be praised. Glory to God. Well, if you need your Bible, you can raise your hand. They'll bring you one. Glory be to God. Well, let's go to Hebrews chapter 10. We're going to talk about today. The title of today's message is Why Go to Church? Why are we supposed to go to church? Does anybody have a simple answer?
He commands.
Because he commands you to. He told you to. Amen. That's what my first one is, because he said to. Amen. And when God commands us things, we don't have a choice. The only choice we have is whether we're going to obey him or not obey him. And we was talking this morning, y'all was talking about him being Lord of your life. And the fact of the matter is, if you don't go to church faithfully, he ain't Lord of your life. And I ain't talking about you on vacation, out of town, had to work, sick. I'm talking about just a regular thing. You decide just to stay home and not attend worship service. Then you might need to check and see if you're really saved, because the Bible tells us that we have a genuine love for the brothers and sisters come inside of us when we get born again, and we got a new voice. So when it's time to go to church, that voice is saying, it's church time. It's church time. He's telling me and you it's time to go to church. But if you refuse him over and over and over again, your heart will become callous to it, and you'll get turned over to a mind that don't even think about it no more. And then the devil convinces you, okay. You know, I talked to a pastor this morning. I said, have all your members come back from the pandemic? He said, about 50% of them. He said, 50% of them think they can just stay home and, you know, watch TV and everything. And he said, I said, well, how you doing? He said, well, I had to put money out of my savings account into the church. I said, yeah, it's a shame they stay home and they think they ain't supposed to send their tithes and offerings to take care of the church. Because the Bible teaches us God had a plan. It's called tithes and offerings. I have never got a statement, and I say this often, I have never got a statement from Georgia Power and they send a bill and say, man, y'all are a church and we just want to bless y'all this month. You have no bills due. I've never got it from them, the water company, the rent people, anybody has never sent me that and said, you ain't got to worry about it because we know you're a church. And a lot of churches, they may think that because you have one of the number one things churches don't do is pay their bills. So you have churches out here that won't pay their bills and they think everybody owes them because they're a church. I've seen pastors, they try to get stuff for nothing because they a pastor. Hello? They ought to be believing God for money just like We have to, you know, when you're a church member, they ought to be believing God for money too, amen? Instead of coming up with ideas of how to get deals and all that stuff. Now, if the Lord sends you a deal, you get a deal. But you shouldn't go in there and think because you're a pastor, somebody's supposed to be doing something for you for free. I've seen pastors get estimates from people that do work in the church, and they want that person really to do that work for free. No, if they own a company, you ought to pay them to do it because that's how they make their living. Well, you don't get too many amens when you talk about stuff like that. I know the pastors that are listening, they out there saying amen, amen, amen. I hope they are. Because you're not supposed to expect that. Now, if you do work for a pastor and you say, well, or anybody, and the Lord tells you why you're doing it, just give this to him and tell him I love them. Well, that's between you and the Lord and obeying him. But going to church is just it's to obey the Lord. And Hebrews chapter 10, I'm going to be reading out of the New Living Translation on this one, starting at verse 23, says, let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep his promises. Y'all know God, y'all know God can be trusted. The people need to learn how to trust him. Because if you're not doing what he tells you to do, then you're really not trusting him. Next verse. Let us think of ways to motivate one another. Think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good work. You can keep rolling. And let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do. See, he done told us 2,000 years ahead of time, or ever how far ahead of time this was written, that people are already going to be neglecting their time coming together. They neglecting it as a matter of some is. I got this new study Bible. It says it's important that believers assemble together, however the meeting might be conducted. See, you're supposed to come together to meet where God sends you to worship, so you can the meeting can be conducted to bring honor and glory to Jesus and to be led by the Holy Ghost in everything that you do. He says, but encouraging one another, especially now. Do y'all know now is more prevalent than when now was then? Now is closer than it was last week when I said now. It's more closer to him coming back because the return is drawing near. It ain't going to be long before Jesus splits the eastern sky, you know, and it ain't going to be long before you hear the trumpet sound, and it ain't going to be long before we're in heaven for eternity if you know Jesus Christ, your personal Savior. And all he's asking and telling me and you to do and commanding us to do is while we're here on earth to come together and to worship him and make him the center focus of this meeting as we come together. That he wants us to come and worship and praise and magnify him. What did he create us for? He created us to be able to make a choice of whether or not we was going to worship him or not. Hallelujah. That's what he created us for. He made us a vessel, and the Bible tells us we are the temple, the house, the vessel of the Holy Ghost. So the only way the Holy Ghost can live inside of me and you and abide with us is if we're obeying what Christ taught us. Because if you're disobedient, the Holy Ghost ain't there except for telling you to repent. Hello, he's telling you to repent. That's what he's there for. This morning people could not be going to church and saying, you know, their pastor's on the TV and all this stuff and don't even know who he is, probably don't even know his middle name or his phone number. But he's their pastor. I've had people come to church here before and tell, one of them told me Pastor Hagee was their pastor. I said, well, let's call him. You got him in your phone? Let's call him. And they just look at you like you're crazy. When's the last time you talked to him? No, when you got a pastor's supposed to speak into your life. He's supposed to be, when you're wrong, he's supposed to be correcting you, rebuking you. And when you're doing right, he's supposed to be edifying you. How? Through the word. The word is preached so it rebukes, corrects, or edifies. So if you're obeying everything that's in here that you're getting ministered to, it ought to be edifying you that I'm doing that. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. But it shouldn't cause you to look down on somebody that ain't doing it. It should cause you to look at that person and pray for them that their eyes are open so they know that Jesus really loves them. And when people really know Jesus loves them, it'll change their whole life. That's what it's all about, y'all, is them getting to know him. Well, how are they going to know that? Well, he tells us, don't neglect your meeting together, as a manner of some is, but exhorting one another as you see the day approaching. When you come to church, you ought to be exhorting somebody. You shouldn't really come to church and tear people down. Hello. You ought to let Jesus use the people that he's put in positions to correct the people under them. It ain't your responsibility to correct somebody that God's put under my care. Hello? It's my responsibility. And I have to answer to him for that. It's not my responsibility to correct your children. It's your responsibility. And you will answer for that. But if they come around me or stay with me, I'm going to correct them. So if you don't want to get corrected, then praise God. Don't let them come with me. Hello? Hannah came down to our house, and I said, you know I can whoop you, don't you? She said, yes, Amanda told me. I said, and I will if I need to. And Ben was talking about going out and eat. Last week we had Hannah and Raven with us, and we was leaving the house, and I said, where y'all want to go to eat? One of them said McDonald's, one of them said Wendy's. I said, okay, we're going to Burger King. So I went straight on to Burger King. Hello? Because I'm not going to let kids dictate what I'm going to do. And Yvette over, she said, well, we could go to one place and to the other. I said, you have lost your mind. They are 9 and 10. Hello? So you'd be driving on. If you had five, you'd be driving five different places. And then if we're going to do that, we're going to have to go somewhere else because I don't want that. I didn't even want Burger King. But out of the three closest, they picked two of them, so I said, we're going to the other. Amen. You have to let kids know that they can't run your life every day, because if they think they can, they will. They'll run it every single day. Sometimes you need to learn just to tell them no. I used to say, my kids ask me something, I just tell them no, just tell them no. Just to see what happened. You know, and if they acted rebellious stuff, then they would get that no. I always tell people when you ask me something and I say no, go pray. Don't complain. See what the Lord says about it. He can change my heart. Complaining ain't gonna get you nowhere. Hello, because see, I know where your heart is when you start complaining. You're in rebellion, and rebellion is like witchcraft to God. So I know you ain't been talking to him lately. He's been talking to you, telling you to repent. These people sitting at home, that I have people tell me all the time, y'all, they come to church all the time. They never show up. Some have been telling me for years. For years they come. And if I talk to them this afternoon, they say, I'm coming. I'll see you on Sunday. They got more than they'll tell me next Sunday or third Sunday. I'll see you on Sunday. That way when I see them, it'll be on Sunday. Well, they figure they ain't lying. But the thing is, what is your heart when you're saying that? God knows your heart. He don't just look at your lips talking. He knows what your heart and what's the motive of your heart when you're talking to him. Verse 26. Praise the Lord. Dear friends, he's talking to friends here. That's, you know, friends are somebody that's really obeying him. If we deliberately continue shining after we have received knowledge, sinning, not shining. Some people think they are shining when they're sinning, but you're not. It's dark. After we have received knowledge of the truth, there is no longer any sacrifice that will cover these sins. No, you're just out there willfully sinning, doing what you want to do. There's no why is there no sacrifice for somebody out there willingly sinning? It tells you that no longer have a sacrifice that will cover the sins. Next verse. This is only the terrible expectation of God's judgment and the raging fire that will consume his enemies. The reason that there's no sacrifice for somebody that's continuing in sin is because they don't have a repentant heart. They continue in sin. Y'all, there's people that live in a relationship, boyfriend and girlfriend, having sex. They pray every day for God to forgive them for having sex and having it again tomorrow. There's no repentant heart there. There's people that are alcoholics that pray all the time for God to forgive them for getting drunk and doing this and doing that, and then they do it again next weekend. There's no repentant heart there. And all the Hail Marys in the world ain't going to save you when you stand before God. Hello, Mary's crying because they've made a religion out of her. It ain't about her. It's about Jesus. She knew it was about Jesus. And it seems like we ought to know that. It's about him. So don't think you can just keep continue walking in sin and you can ask for forgiveness tonight and think you're forgiven. No, if there's no turning from that darkness, there's no forgiveness for that darkness. And turning means you don't expect to do it no more. So if you was a boyfriend or girlfriend, y'all, you were living with your boyfriend or girlfriend and you repented for it, guess what? The first step would be move to another room. The next step would probably be move out and ask God if this is really the one for me. God, we've had people come to church here, y'all, and they live together. They don't stay long. Why? They don't want to hear that. When you want to sin, you don't want to hear somebody preaching that what you're in is sin. And if you don't want to repent, the devil will eventually get you out of there. So he can keep you in that sin because he's read the Bible. And he knows no sin's going to enter in. God, the devil knows this Bible better than most Christians. He can quote it and add a little word to it or something and change it to make you think you're okay with him. Hello. But you ain't if you ain't doing what he commanded you to do in the New Testament. And this is not a suggestion. He says, do not forsake this. That sounds, he's telling us, don't let that happen in your life. Don't forsake this assembling yourself as a matter of some is, but exhorting one another as you see that day approaching. He wants us to come together to exalt Jesus. He don't want us to come together to exalt one another. He wants us to come together to exalt him. He just wants us to edify each other. Build them. Man, hang in there. Man, Jesus is coming back soon. Hang in there. Keep staying faithful. It won't be long before you're going to get a payout. Hello? People work at companies. People say, man, just hang on. 10 years, you can retire. 20 years, you can retire. 30 years, you can just walk off. Man, you start. So just stay in it until you see the benefits of it. Well, I tell people, just stay in it. Just follow Jesus. Do what he says. Don't get caught up in yourself doing what you want to do. Because the fact of the matter is, if this morning, if you listen to this tape, this recording, and you're telling me that you're a Christian and you don't go to church, you ain't obeying him. So he ain't your Lord. He's only your Lord when you say, yes, Lord. When you read Isaiah, he said, woe is me, I'm a man of unclean lips. But when he realized who the Lord was, he submitted to him. We got to submit to what he's telling us to do. Each and every one of us got to submit to it. And then you got, what is the motive of your heart for wanting people to come to church? I know what Jesus' motive is. He told us. He said the house should be full for what? The Father's glory. So you should want people to come to church so the Father will be glorified. You should want this place being slapped right over and people waiting outside for the Father's glory, not for ours. For the Father to come and do things in their life to change them, to turn their life around, to deliver them, to set them free. Glory. Man, we would see a lot more healings happen if during praise and worship people would just start worshiping him. We would see things change more in the service if we would just yield ourselves to him and worship him. Because the woman that wasn't even a Jew, when her daughter was sick, she started worshiping him and her daughter got healed. She tapped into the cross before the cross even happened. Hallelujah. He desires that worship. That's what he desires for me and you. Praise the Lord. Next verse. For anyone who refuses to obey, now he just told us some things that we need to do. Then he said anyone who refuses to obey the law of Moses was put to death without mercy. And all they had to do was have two or three witnesses. Y'all, they could have been two or three people got together alive. Now they did on Jesus and people were put to death. Next verse. Just think how much worse the punishment will be for those who have trampled on the Son of God. When you disobey Jesus and do what you want to and don't obey him, you're trampling on Jesus. When you don't obey his commandments and what he's told us to do, you're trampling on him. Why not just live a good life and do what he says? Hello. And have treated the blood of the covenant which made us holy as if it were common and unholy. The blood that made you holy, you're treating it as common and unholy. In other words, you think there's no power in it. Why are these denominations getting together wanting to take the blood out of the Bible? the blood out of the gospel. You take the blood out, there ain't no gospel. The blood's what brought the gospel. His blood shed on the cross. He was tore apart for me and you so that we can live in victory every day. If there ain't no blood, there ain't no Christian faith. There ain't no born-again believer if there ain't no blood. As if it were common and holy, and have insulted and disdained the Holy Spirit who brings God's mercy to us. Man, don't let yourself fall into this place where you bring disdain to the Holy Spirit. Like he ain't nothing. Like he's just another spirit. No, he's the Holy Spirit. And if Jesus is Lord of your life, then the Holy Spirit should be prevalent in your life. He should be leading, guiding, and directing you every day. And when you continually turn against his leading, eventually you won't even get a leading no more. And then you try to convince people that you're still a Christian, the Holy Ghost is still there, and he talks to you all the time and tells you this and tells you that, when really in reality, all he'd be telling you would be repent. Repent like John the Baptist and Jesus and Pastor Robert said, repent. You don't hear that in a lot of pulpits today. You can turn on the TV, don't hear them say repent. They think everything's okay. Grace covers everything. No, grace ain't going to cover nothing until you repent and you activate grace. That's when grace comes running. Hello. If you get something you ain't supposed to get, that ain't grace. That's mercy. That's somebody was praying for you and God showed you mercy. Think about those people out there, y'all, that don't have nobody in their family praying for them. What do they got to turn to? That's why you hear about a lot of people that end up dead and this and that happened because they didn't have nobody praying for them. There was no mercy shown. Better be careful what you do when it's against the Holy Ghost. When you try to make excuses of why you ain't obeying the Bible. You try to make excuses of why you ain't obeying the commandments that he's told you to obey in the Word. He commands you to love your enemies and you try to make an excuse of why you don't love that person. When really you ain't following his word no more because you got away from him and you don't love him and he can't love you according to the word. Well, you don't obey him and take people's sin away when they don't deserve it just like he did you. There's totally nothing between me and Jesus. He already forgave me. Even if I wasn't a Christian and was out here in the world, there's nothing between me and him except for one sin. I ain't believed on him yet. And once I believe on him, he takes all that sin away. It's gone. I can just come right into his presence. Why? He's already forgave me. He already took it away. That's what you can treat your family and friends and co-workers. Forgive them ahead of time. Take their sin away. Then when they come back in your presence, you ain't mad at the devil at them no more. You don't give them faces and look at them crazy. Hello. Man, mercy will show up and grace will show up and do all kinds of things in our life if we'll let them do it. Glory. I'm so happy that summer's almost over, so everybody get back to church. Hallelujah. So, I'm glad people are blessed and could go on vacations and stuff like that. You know, I like going on, but I miss people. I don't know about y'all, but I miss people when they ain't at church. Hallelujah. Praise God. I miss them. How about y'all? So you got to make up your stake in church, and then if you sick, you stay home. Hello, do you get well? I mean, you go to the doctor, y'all, and you take a test, and he said you got the COVID, the flu, the bronchitis, or anything, strep throat, and it's contagious. Stay home. Everybody here ain't in that much faith. We don't want the whole church, have a church next week to have strep throat. Glory. Stay home and use some wisdom sometimes. That's what YouTube is for, to watch at home in cases like that. Not for you to sit at home every Sunday with your coffee and watch it after we done had church, because we not live. You watching a retake in case you didn't know. It ain't 10:30 in the morning when you're watching this. Praise the Lord. So you got to know that you got to obey him, and one reason we go to church, because he told us to. Next verse. Hallelujah. They come up with all kinds of excuses why they don't go to church. I've heard 1,001. I need to write a book, 1,001 excuses not to go to church, and there'd probably be 2,000 in it. For we know the one who said, I will take revenge, I will pay them back. He also said the Lord will judge his own people. God, the Lord's going to judge his own people. The Bible says that judgment starts in the house of the Lord. We expected God to judge the White House and Las Vegas and San Francisco, and he will. But it starts in the house of the Lord. He wants to see if he's really your Lord. Does he really tell you what to do when you do it? Or not? Next verse. It is a terrible thing to fall into the hands of a living God. A terrible thing to fall into the hand. It wouldn't matter if we fell into the hands of Buddha. He dead. It wouldn't matter if he fell into the hands of Muhammad. He dead. I don't care what they say he done. It don't matter if you fell into the hands of Moon. He dead. No, when you fall into the hands of Jesus and the Father, and you're not right with them, it's a terrible thing to fall into them hands that has the power not just to kill you, but to kill you and then throw you in the hell. That's a terrible thing to fall into them hands. So if I was you, I think I'd just start obeying Jesus and do what he said. So when you stand before him, he'll say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Amen. Well done. Well, I watched this movie this week called I Am Not Him. It was talking about this guy that the Lord visited. People started getting healed. And then a couple of them died. So they wanted to put him in jail, give him 32 years. Because people died that he prayed for. They died. And they said he was giving them false, you know, hope and stuff like that. And one of them, the main one, he was supposed to live 6 weeks and he only lived 3 days. And he's like, well, he was supposed to be dead in 6 weeks anyway. What are you doing to him? What are you telling him? He said, I'm only telling him I can pray for him. It ain't up to me if they get healed or not. It's up to God. God's the one that heals them. You know, so they was going to convict him, you know, and right before they read the conviction, the whole courthouse started shaking and lit up. It's like the Holy Ghost just invaded the whole courthouse, you know, and the judge started trembling so much, he said, case dismissed. You know, one day we're going to stand in the courts of heaven. And there's going to be a trial going on for each and every one of us. Is Jesus going to rise up on your behalf and say, Father, they're mine. I plead the blood of the Lamb to take care of anything they've done. By my word, their word and their testimony, they're okay. Or is Jesus going to sit over on his hands and he can't do nothing because you really didn't acknowledge him and make him the Lord of your life? I like a song Carver used to sing. He's either Lord of all or not Lord at all. Carver was talking about how he said he can't go down to the... He said the only way he could go to the beach and stay holy was to be stuck his head in the sand. Hello? Which I know the things that, but there is another way. Be sanctified by Jesus and the Holy Ghost where things, the lust of the flesh and the eyes don't move you. I had the older man that led me to Jesus. He told me, he said, when you see a beautiful woman, he said, they're beautiful, I tell you. He said, the devil comes to me and tells me all the time. You see these women out there, they got this dress on, that dress on. He said, you know, we look at them and say, why are they wearing that? Well, what can they wear? They're beautiful. They're going to be beautiful regardless. He said, you just tell the devil. He said, man, that's right. My father made a beautiful woman, and that's my sister in Christ. Hello? But see, you got people going to church. My friend of mine, he said, sport coat willies go to church, and all they're doing is looking for a woman that they can hook up and deceive. And before long, you see them, they got four or five women in the church, and they come to church trying to worship a holy God living unholy in the pews. You can't, he knows everything about you before you come in here this morning. He knows whether or not he accepted your praise this morning, or he couldn't, because you ain't doing right and ain't living right and ain't living holy before him. He knows who you are today. He knows who I am today. Hello? He knows if I had the right motivation and my heart was right when I gave my tithes and offerings. He knows if my heart was right when I was worshiping him this morning. He knows where my heart was. He knows everything about me. And guess what? You too. He knows everything about you too. Let's go back to verse 24 right here in Hebrews 10. Verse 24, it says, he said, let us think of ways to motivate one another. So you got to understand, when you come to church this morning, you're really supposed to come this morning to try to, you should have been thinking on ways to motivate your who you're going to see this morning. To lift them up. Not to cut them down and cut the feet out from under them and say, where was you at last week, you unholy heathen? No, you're supposed to think about things, how to motivate people. And come in. I hope you come to worship Jesus today. I did. Praise God. Are you ready? Well, let's get ready. Hello? We got to learn. Man, this is our brothers and sisters we come to church with this morning. So we got to think of ways to motivate each other. In what? In love and good works. We got to teach people how to walk out this thing, this life, and to give good works to God so He can put them up there. So they'll be waiting on you when you get to heaven. He says, store up your treasures in heaven, not here on this earth. But you're supposed to have things on this earth too. How in the world can you be rich and not have things on this world? You know, they had the $1.2 billion lottery Friday night. I said, this is just a chance. Like, I went out and bought two tickets. Not yet. I went out and bought two tickets. Guess how many numbers I hit out of 12 numbers?
One.
Zero. But see, I don't think it bothers him. You go out and buy a ticket or two for something that big and take a chance. My goodness, but you got to understand too, when you win something like that, people's coming from all over to you. And you got to be able to follow Jesus in everything that you do, because the love of money is the root of all evil. So you might not even have the love of money and then win a big one, and now you got it.
Yeah.
It's overtaking you. And people are treating you now like you're God. Hello? Instead of giving Him honor, instead of giving Him praise, instead of glorifying Him. And if you don't believe in the lottery and you got mad at me because I just said I bought two tickets, why don't you just forgive me and take my sin away and I didn't deserve it like I did you?
Amen.
Well, praise God. Now, if you went out there and spent $40,000, sold your business, bought $40,000 lottery tickets, and you didn't win nothing, you stupid. they ain't much hope for you. Hello, I've heard stories of people doing stuff like that. You don't put your family in jeopardy if it's just to buy one ticket. I remember when I used to deliver papers, when this thing first came out, man, I would see families in there when it got high, and they'd have a baby in a diaper, no shoes, snot running down its nose, and they in there trying to come up with money to buy a ticket. I wanted to holler, buy some milk! Feed the baby! My goodness! You know it's 40 degrees outside, don't you? But you know, you have to stay in your own lane. Guess what? Because that's where they're at. And if you can't get them in a place where you can meet with them regularly and disciple them, all you're going to do is make them mad at you, and every time they see you, they ain't going to be around you. Hello? So we got to learn to do this and walk this out in love. Go to verse 25. He tells here that we're supposed to not neglect the meekness of men, but he said, what did he say there? But encourage one another. We should have come to church today to encourage one another. About what? The day of Jesus is coming, y'all. He's coming back soon. Hey, hold on. Don't let nothing come in and get you away from the Master. You this close to Him. Don't let nothing come in and take you out. You this close to Him. Stay with Him. Hallelujah. Like this morning, Mike had to leave because he got a call. Gary, they think he had a stroke in his house, his brother. So we pray. We believe in God that he's going to be okay. Amen. We believe in God. He said that God's going to rescue him and show up. Hello. We just got to trust God. He knows what he's doing. He can do whatever he needs to do. Amen. I don't know where Zero went. He didn't go cook no eggs, did he? He had to go to work. Praise God. He had to go do a drawing. Oh, 10-4. Okay. Where you at, Zero? Praise the Lord. If he went out there and cooked some eggs, we're going to bring us an omelet back in or something. Praise God. I didn't know you'd get up with something. Sometimes people get called to different things. I know, you know, a lot of Evangelist Shadbaugh, you say you used to have the girls come to church because they had them out there cooking that chicken for the preacher after the service. I always wonder why they got them cooking all this stuff the same ones and they never get to hear the message. Hello, you got people there cooking all this and they never get to hear the message. I ain't talking about every now and then you do a revival. I'm talking about every Sunday. Hello. Yeah, that's why you need more than one or two. So you can rotate them. Amen. Rotate them. Praise God. Rotate them. Next verse, I got to go to page 2. My fingers don't take them apart as much like they used to. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13 in the New Living Translation. Praise God. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13 through 15. He's telling us here to serve one another. He's showing me and you here, we got to learn to serve each other. If you're going to follow Jesus, you got to be a servant. You can't go to Jesus and be a Christian and you're served all the time. He tells us, for you have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters. He's talking to the church. He ain't calling us to be, we used to have pastor appreciation things here at the church and banquets and you know, and they want to put me up there and on a table in front of everybody and do all this. And that's, you know, that's fine every now and then. But the problem is when you got a pastor and he thinks he's supposed to have that. When he thinks everybody's supposed to serve him. God didn't call you to serve too, Pastor? Are you born again? Then he told us to serve each other. So every now and then, sometimes the pastor is to serve. Amen. Well, didn't get too shallow. Didn't have too much on that. Praise the Lord. He calls us to serve. He don't want you always to be the one that's honored. And we got to learn the teachings of Jesus. When you come into a church, I don't care who you think you are. You better be careful when you go up and try to sit in the best seat. Because the person might be late. They're supposed to sit in that seat. And they may have to ask you to move, and that embarrasses you. Jesus taught that. It's best just to sit in a lowly seat. And if they want you to move you up, then they come and ask you to move up. Amen? Well, praise God anyway.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. But don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Do you think because you're free in Christ, you can do what you want to? I can live any way I want to. No, you can't. You end up in hell. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another. In love. Use your freedom to serve one another in love. Next verse. Serve one another in love. In other words, keep it in love. For the whole law can be consumed up in this one commandment. And we know to love your neighbor as yourself. The only way you love your neighbor as yourself is if you love yourself. Jesus said, love one another as I've loved you. Love one another. You got to love the one first. You ain't going to love your neighbors if you don't love yourself. Love one another. Love one. I got to love myself. Take my sin away when I don't deserve it if I'm going to love you right. I can't be mad at myself and love you. I can't love you right and I'm just PO'd at myself. I got to learn to get to the blood for myself so that I can love everybody around me right. Amen. Praise God. Next verse. But if you are always biting and devouring one another, watch out. Watch out, you always tearing each other down, talking about each other, complaining about each other. Beware of destroying one another. And that's when you can go back to the Hebrews and say, it's going to be a dangerous thing to fall into the hands of a living God, and all you've been doing is church biting and devouring instead of coming to serve and submit. Hello? And love one another and provoke one another to good works. Really, really love each other. See, God knows your heart. He knows if you really love each other. Or if you're just mad at the devil and everybody, you just came this morning because you just wanted to come to church so everybody know you came. Colossians chapter 3. Some people just go to church because they want people to know they came. I come to church because he commanded me to, and I want him to know I came. Amen. I want him to know that I put him first this morning over my flesh. Because this morning, y'all, my flesh wanted to sleep. Hello? I mean, that alarm clock went off and I wanted to knock it through the wall. Any of y'all ever had them days when a beep, I'm about to beep you. You know, they want to knock that thing through the wall. So I cut it off and eventually she's still a. So I said, we got that Alexa thing, so I hollered in there, it's time to get up. She didn't get up, so I set the alarm on the Alexa. It went off, she turned it off, still didn't get up. So I said it again. Hello? So here she comes. I done fell back and leap in the recliner. I got Jensen Frank on. I'm just sleeping. So she comes out. It's 8:40. I said, I know what time it is. I'll be in that shop. I'm worried about you waking up. I'm glad you got up when I fell asleep. Praise the Lord. See, if you ain't got nobody there to help you, you don't need to set the recliner after you get up. Hello? You don't need to turn that alarm clock. You need to get up on your feet when that alarm clock goes off. Get in that shower. Wake up. Right? Throw some water in your face. Do something. See, when you ain't with somebody else, you're the one that's got to make yourself stay awake. You got somebody else. If you lived in the house with me, don't worry. It's church time. I'm going to remind you 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times if I need to. Hello? Y'all up in there? Get up. It's time. It's almost time. Y'all going to be late. I said, Mimi, you driving this morning? No, I'm not driving. I said, well, you better shift gears. Because we got to get there. Praise God. Since God chose you to be holy people, He loves you, must clothe yourself. How many of y'all got dressed this morning? All of you. I know I see you. Hello? You got to clothe yourself. You should have clothed yourself this morning, but you don't just need to do this when you come to church. You need to do this tomorrow before you go to work, Tuesday before you go to work, before you go to school, before you go anywhere. Every day of the week, you need to clothe yourself with tender-hearted mercy. You know why? Because you're going to run into some people and you're going to have to give them mercy. Because if you don't, they're going to wear you out. You got to be kind to them. They may be mean to you, but you still got to be kind. You got to walk in humility towards them because they ain't going to walk in it. You got to walk in gentleness with some people because some of them have been hurt so bad, if you kind of come off too rough with them, you just run them off. You got to do it with gentleness and patience. A lot of people you have to be patient with because they just walk in their ignorance. Remember, Jesus and the Father said, my people perish from a lack of knowledge. That's ignorance of what He wants for you in this life. So you got to quit putting other things before Him. Verse 13. Next verse. Make allowances for each other's fault. Did any of y'all make allowances? See, if it bothered you that I said something about the lottery, see, if you'd have made allowances before you got here this morning, it wouldn't need to bother you. You'd ahead of time forgave people. Me too. Yvette told me, she said, if you can't let nobody know if you win, can't you? Honey, I said, if you win that much money, after a while they gonna know you won something. I said, when I build a 10-foot wall around the house with the big gate and the 10 Dobermans, they gonna know something happened over there. Hello? And everybody on Facebook knows that I done got 7 Corvettes for you. One for every day. People say, what do you say, you don't like dogs? No, I get 10 dogs, they'll be outside and I'll have somebody to take care of them. I won't even have to pet them if I don't want to. Hello? Y'all, I've always liked Dobermans. Y'all remember that show back in the 70s day where they had them Dobermans robbing banks? Any of y'all see that where they trained them dogs and all that? And so they robbed the banks. They never had to go in there and all. Them dogs are smart dogs. My daddy, when I was about 15, he bought me 2 Dobermans. I went out there one morning to feed them. I stuck the food through there. That dog grabbed a hold of mine and bit my hand. Man, them dogs were gone that afternoon. Hello? Man, they you know, dogs can be crazy too. Some of them you have to cast the devil out of. I went on my friend's house, the dog, he was wagging his tail, you know, up on the fence like this, wagging his tail. I went down to pet him, he was, hurr! I said, you got a devil in you. I turned to my cousin, I said, that dog's got a devil. You need to cast a devil at that dog. Wagging his tail, they go to bite you. Hello? I said, if I'd been in the game with him, I'd have had to kick him to get him off of me. I mean, you know, you have to watch him though sometimes, y'all. They will be crazy. The Lord forgive you, so you must forgive others. See, he's telling me and you, if we're going to, you don't have to forgive nobody. You got a choice. But he's telling you here that if you're going to follow him and do what he says, then you must forgive people. If you're going to be in his kingdom and do what he says. 1 Peter chapter, we'll finish this next week. Praise God. I'm coming back. I'll be back next week. I don't have to finish it all today. Praise the Lord. That verse right there was for Mike anyway. I told Mike this morning, I said, I got a verse this morning for you. Amen. So we'll get that verse to him. He'll be here next week, so he'll get to hear it too. Praise the Lord Jesus. Man, I'm just so happy to be a Christian and follow Jesus and do what he says. You know, I believe we're coming up in services where the Holy Ghost is going to be here so powerful that people, just during me preaching, they're just going to come up here and start getting it all because God's convicted you of something that you ain't doing that you should be doing or something you're doing you shouldn't be doing. And all you got to do is just come down here and just say a little prayer and get it right. But if you say, well, I ain't got to come down there. No, but that's just an act of confession or show of man. I'm for real about this thing. Devil, you ain't going to keep me bondage of this thing no more. I'm going to do what the Lord commands me to do. So you got to make a decision. Is he Lord or is he not? If he's Lord, you really, once you make the choice that you're going to serve him as Lord, there's really no more choices after that. You just follow him and do what he says. You're obeying him. Once you make him your Lord, that's the choice you made right then. Then you live that life. Donna needs to say today. She needs one of them Jamaica naps. Eat a plantain and go to sleep. Amen. Anybody need to get saved this morning? Give your whole life to Jesus? Anybody need to rededicate your life? Got sickness or pain in your body? Y'all better be praying for your family members that don't know Jesus Christ, their personal Savior. Because we're going to see death. People are going to start dying, y'all. We get close to the end. They're going to start dying. The devil is releasing a battle. And people are going to start dying just because he finally had the door open and he's going to kill them. And they're going to start leaving this earth faster and faster and faster. And we can't preach everybody into heaven. I'm not going to. So if somebody in your family dies and they don't go to church, best thing you do, not call me. Because more likely I'm going to say no. And if there are changes in that dude, then I'm going to probably say some things at the funeral that you're going to get mad at me at. Because I'm not lying for nobody. Hello? I'm not preaching everybody into heaven. Especially if I don't know if they lived a life to get them there. Hey, well, praise the Lord. If you want somebody to preach your relative into heaven and they didn't serve God, you need to get the chaplain to do it. And then when you get there to heaven, you'll be so surprised because they didn't make it. And you'll be wanting to go get the chaplain. The chaplain may not even be there. Hello. So you better make sure your life is right now with Jesus, and then you better make sure your family that you're telling them about him and not letting them just do what they want to do. But you're telling them, no, Jesus, they say, the people tell me, I ain't got to go to church to be a Christian. I said, no, you ain't got to go to church to be a Christian. But when you're a Christian, you want to go to church. If you was a Big Mac, you'd want to be at McDonald's. You wouldn't want to be at Burger King. Come on now, if you ever went to Burger King and got a Big Mac, no, you got a Whopper. Hello, and vice versa. Well, if you want to find Christians, you ought to be able to go to church and find them. Because they should want to be there. They should want to come with the fellowship of other believers. Well, praise God. Anybody need prayer this morning? Anybody, you need prayer? Your sister? What's this, y'all, brother? Sister? Y'all, sister. You talking about the Jehovah's Witness? Father, we just ask you right now to let the nurse, a doctor, or somebody in that hospital invade her room, tell her about the Jesus Christ, the true Lord, and let it open her eyes to the understanding of who Jesus really is. We ask you right now to open her eyes to how much Jesus really loves her. And touch her. Lord, we thank you for healing her. both spiritually, physically, and emotionally. And we thank you. We're going to hear a praise report about this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Golden.
Yeah, so that lady,
McDonald's. All right, Megan, we just ask you, Holy Ghost, invade Megan's life. Open her eyes to how much Jesus really loves her. The height, breadth, width, and depth of his love for her. And let it change her life. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Man, I'm excited about this. How about y'all? I'm excited to see what the Lord's going to do in True Christian Fellowship. Amen. Glory. Well, we love y'all. Y'all have a good week. We'll see y'all.